Hello, everyone, and welcome to this WealthTrack interview with a top personal finance reporter and columnist and a former colleague of mine when I worked at the Wall Street Journal. He is Jonathan Clements. He still writes a column for the Wall Street Journal, only this time for their Sunday edition. He wrote a weekly personal finance column for them called Getting Going for many years. He is an author of several books, including The Little Book of Main Street Money. But he has a new book out, which has given me an opportunity to speak to him again. Actually, I was looking for an excuse, and he gave me one. It is called simply Jonathan Clements Money Guide 2015. It is being published as both an ebook and a hardcover. It's going to be available January 1st, and it is getting great recommendations from the likes of Burton Malkiel, Charlie Ellis, both WealthTrack guests, and me. So, Jonathan, it's great to have you here, and I can't wait to talk about the book.
It's great to be with you, Consuelo.
So this is not supposed to be a hostile interview, but here's my first question. Why do we need another money guide from you? Because, you know, the Little Book of Main Street Money was and is still terrific.
It's a great question, Consuelo. I mean, the world is littered with personal finance books. I mean, we've taken a good chunk out of the Amazon producing all these things. So why do we need another one? Well, there are certain things that are unique about the Jonathan Clements Money Guide 2015. I mean, unlike the previous books I put out, this is designed to be a comprehensive financial guide. I cover every financial topic out there, everything from retirement to real estate, paying for college, insurance, estate planning, everything is in there. And the other thing that is notable about the guide is it's designed to be an annually updated personal finance guide. In other words, I'm going to be reissuing this every year with, you know, some changes to the text. But in addition, it's going to be updated with the latest numbers on the economy, the markets, tax rates, and also some statistics on how the typical American is faring financially. I think one of the things that's most interesting to people is, how do I stack up against my neighbors? When you go through the book, you'll be able to get some key statistics on exactly what your neighbors are up to.
You've also done something really different, is that you've taken full advantage of the ebook format. So how does that work? And tell us about the fact that, you know, here you are, you're a weekly columnist for the journal. You're on a weekly deadline, but in this case, you're going to be updating it, you know, as of December 31st. You're not going to take a holiday this year.
No, there won't be a whole lot of champagne in the Clements household on December 31st. The goal is to update the book as of the market close on December 31st so that we have all the latest market stats as well as the latest numbers on the economy and so on. So the book, when it comes out on January 1, will be incredibly timely. And that's available, you know, possible thanks to the introduction of e-books and also print-on-demand traditional books. So you can finish a book one day and have it ready for sale the next. In addition, the ebook format allows you to do certain things that you can't do with a traditional book. For instance, you can include hyperlinks to internet sites where, say, you can find some great calculators to help you with retirement savings or college savings. Also, with an ebook, you can hyperlink within the book. So if there's a one section of the book, and then there's relevant information in a distant part of the book, you can include a hyperlink so people can click through to that other section of the book and really get a well-rounded sense of the financial topic that they're tackling. One of the unique things about ebooks is that, in a sense, you get away from this notion that, you know, the author is going to lead you from page one all the way through to the last page. Instead, with an ebook, people can go through the book at any way they want. They can click through from one chapter to the next, depending on what's interesting to them. It's really it's a unique way of reading a book.
Talk to us about what's different about managing our money in 2015. You've got two decades of experience writing personal finance columns. You know, hearing from readers all the time. You know, what's really different for us in 2015?
I think in 2015 there's two big upsides and one big downside. So the two big upsides are really developments that have been a long time coming, but, you know, have become more and more evident. One, we've seen investment costs fall dramatically over the last two decades. Investors today can invest at investment costs that would have made institutional investors drool 2 decades ago. And much of this has to do with exchange-traded index funds. The exchange-traded funds are not only competing fiercely with one another, but also they're competing fiercely with actively managed mutual funds. The result is that expenses across the board are coming down, and that's great for investors. The second thing that's gone on, and again, you can a lot of credit goes to exchange-traded funds, we've seen a proliferation of investment choices. People can now build incredibly sophisticated portfolios. I mentioned institutional investors and, you know, how they would be jealous of the costs that now available to the small investor. Similarly, individual investors today can build portfolios that 20 years ago only the largest institutional investors could build, thanks to all the choice we've seen. We've had these new funds devoted to commodities, to real estate, to obscure parts of the market. I mean, you can go out there and you can buy an ETF or a mutual fund that focuses on some tiny, narrow slice of the market and get very precise market exposure. So those are the two big upsides. What's the downside? The downside is this. Not only do we have incredibly low bond yields that mean that everybody's aware of. I mean, you go out, you buy a CD, you put money in a savings account, you buy a bond mutual fund, your yield is so, so very low. But not only do we have low bond yields, but also we have an incredibly expensive stock market. Stocks today have tripled off the 2009 market low. And not only are they had this huge run, but by almost any market metric that you can think of, U.S. stocks are at the top end of their valuations. And that means that investors really, you know, do not have a great choice out there. They could buy U.S. stocks, which are expensive. They could put their money in CDs or bonds and earn very low yields. And that, to my mind, is the big dilemma that investors face in 2015.
You know, it's interesting because the fact is that we do have this proliferation of investment choices, as you said, and we can invest like institutions. So we've got all these wonderful choices, but it's brings a whole other set of problems. It is so complicated, and it's very difficult to know, you know, how to allocate your assets. It's hard to know which vehicles to buy. And one of your chapters, which with your typical very dry sense of humor, is titled Investing, and the subhead is A Simple Task with a Miserably Low Success Rate. So tell us, you know, how do we use these upsides to our advantage, considering that individuals do have such a miserably low success rate, at least in beating the markets?
Well, the proliferation of choices is, as you suggest, Consuelo, a double-edged sword. It is great to have all of these choices, but having all that choice can also cause people to freeze. So you look at all the mutual funds out there and all the exchange-traded funds and think, I have no idea how to make sense of this mess. I'm just going to leave my money in a savings account because it's just too overwhelming. Well, you know, face up to it. You've got to seize control of your financial life. You have to learn how to invest successfully or you're never going to be able to retire in comfort. So how do you make sense of that mass of mutual funds and exchange-traded funds and other investment options that are out there? In that chapter that you mentioned, Consuelo, what I do is I outline a four-step process to deciding, you know, what your portfolio should look like. And the first step is to figure out what your goals are. If you don't know where you're going, you're never going to get there. So what goals are you saving for? Are you saving for a house down payment? Are you saving for the kids' college education? Are you saving for your own retirement? Once you know that, you'll have a sense for your time horizon and hence how much risk you can afford to take. And once you know that, it leads naturally to step number two, which is settling on your asset allocation. How much of your money are you going to put in stocks? How much in bonds? How much in cash investments? And how much in alternative investments? And again, that's going to be driven heavily by your time horizon. That brings you to the third step, figuring out how you're going to diversify within each of these categories. And this is particularly important in the stock category. How much of your money are you going to put in large company stocks? How much in small company stocks? How much in foreign stocks? How are you going to divide your money between growth and value? As you make those choices, you start to have the framework of your portfolio. The percentage that's going to be in stocks, within the stock portion, how much you're going to have in U.S. stocks and how much you're going to have in foreign stocks. Having laid out that framework, you then get to the fourth and final step, which is selecting investments to build your desired portfolio. Investors work through this four-step process. Selecting investments becomes much easier because you're simply picking the right mutual fund or the right individual securities for each desired slot in your portfolio.
You are very upfront about the fact that you do have your biases. And so speaking of investment biases, come clean and tell us, as you do in the book, incidentally, The Money Guide, you know, what are your biases? And they certainly, if we were to follow your proclivities, it would certainly make our lives a lot easier in making these investment decisions.
Yeah, as you know, Consuelo, and as regular readers of my columns know, I'm a huge, huge fan of indexing. You know, indexing
right.
is that process where you just go out and you buy funds that seek to mimic the performance of the market averages at very, very low costs. I believe, and I've yet to see evidence to suggest otherwise, I firmly believe that most investors, the vast majority of investors, cannot beat the market. You know, the it's not that investors are stupid. The problem is investors are way too smart. Every day, millions of professional amateur investors pore over the market, try to find some way to beat the averages. With all those smart people trying to pick winning investments, if there are any investment bargains to be had, they don't stay that way for very long. As a consequence, for most investors, the right thing to do is to index. Accept the fact that you're not going to beat the market, and instead focus on trying to capture the market's performance at the lowest possible cost.
And Jonathan, earlier in the interview, you mentioned ETFs. Are those ETFs as opposed to mutual funds, index funds? Are those your vehicle of choice?
A lot of it has to do with what. Whether you're going to be adding money regularly to your portfolio. If you have a large lump sum that you plan to invest in index funds and you're not likely to add much to the portfolio in the near future, you're not likely to be doing a lot of selling in the near future, then I would buy exchange-traded index funds because exchange-traded index funds have somewhat lower costs than index mutual funds. You will incur trading costs when you buy and sell, but if you're not doing very much buying and selling, that's not going to be a big issue. On the other hand, if you're like most investors and you gradually build up your portfolio through your working years and then you gradually draw it down once you're retired, probably you're going to be better off with index mutual funds. Yes, those index mutual funds have higher annual expenses, but you're not going to be paying brokerage commissions and bid-ask spreads every time you buy and sell those funds. And so as a consequence, it'll turn out to be cheaper in the long run.
Are there any areas of the market where you are better off, do you think, with active management?
The short answer is no. Occasionally you hear people claim that, okay, yeah, I can see that investing in the S&P 500, those big blue-chip stocks, those are picked over by professional investors, and it's unlikely you're going to beat the market by buying those. But if you're investing in smaller U.S. stocks, you're investing in foreign markets, those markets are less heavily analyzed, and there is indeed a chance to find bargains. Yes. Potentially, there are bargains to be had in those markets, but the reason there are bargains to be had is because it's so much more expensive to trade in those markets. And as a consequence, if you go out and you hire an active manager to help you pick among those stocks, they're going to incur those high costs. Those high costs are going to hurt returns, and in all likelihood, you would have been better off indexing. So no, I don't think there are any parts of the market where you should use an active manager. I think you're better off indexing no matter where you're going to invest.
aren't so much for exceptions to the rule. Another chapter which intrigued me was spending, something for which I am famous for in my family. So spending, and again, the subtitle was, no, this isn't some boring chapter about budgeting. And I'm saying, thank heavens. So what is the spending chapter about?
Well, first of all, let me tell you about the subtitle, no, this isn't some boring chapter about budgeting. I think budgeting, as virtuous as it sounds, is greatly overrated. In fact, after extensive scientific research, I've established that there are only three people in America who create and follow detailed written budgets, and you wouldn't want to go out and have a drink with any of them. Budgeting is completely unnecessary as long as you do one thing, which is to make sure that you save enough every month. You know, typically, you know, you should be saving 12 to 15% every year towards retirement. If you're saving that 12 or 15%, who cares how you're spending the rest of your money? You don't need a detailed written budget. There's no advantage in that. As long as you're saving enough money every month, forget the budget. So what is that particular chapter about? There are two things that I focus on in that chapter. One is the importance of knowing how much of your what your fixed monthly costs are. And the reason that this number is important is it drives so many different financial decisions. If you know how much you're spending on fixed monthly costs, what we're talking about here is rental, mortgage, groceries, utilities, insurance premiums, lease payments on costs.
Right.
All those expenses that are pretty much unchangeable month to month. If you know what that number is, then one, you know how big an emergency fund you should have, because you know the rule of thumb out there is that you should have 6 months of living expenses in an emergency fund. Well, if you lose your job and you're going to have to cover those your living expenses for 6 months, the number you've really got to cover is your fixed cost, because if you're unemployed, you're probably not going to take the expensive vacation. You're probably not going to be eating out a whole lot. So what you need to worry about is covering those fixed monthly costs. Knowing those fixed monthly costs is also crucial as you try to figure out your retirement income strategy. Whatever happens in the financial markets, you want to be sure that you can cover those fixed monthly costs. So knowing that number is critically important. And this leads to an important insight, which is if you want to give yourself a lot of financial breathing room, and if you're thinking about early retirement and you want to save a lot of money every month, one of the key things you ought to do is hold down your fixed monthly costs. As a rule of thumb, I would aim to have fixed monthly costs that are at 50% or less of your gross monthly income. In other words, your pre-tax monthly income. If you can keep your fixed monthly costs at that level or below, you should be in good financial shape.
Very good advice. Last question for you. Rules of the road, keeping yourself on track in 2015, what are the most important rules of the road that you're advising we follow?
Consuelo, I had 31 of them. How can I possibly say which is the most important?
And the nice thing about the ebook format is that I can just look at, you know, number 12 or number 21 or whatever, and I can decide for myself, but I want you to decide this time for us, Jonathan.
The top financial priority for most people every year, meaning those who are still in the workforce, their number one priority should be putting at least enough in their 401k plan to get the full matching employer contribution. That matching employer contribution is free money. And if you aren't putting enough in your 401k plan to get at least that match, you're making a huge, huge mistake. The second biggest financial priority for people in 2015 and indeed in every year is to make sure you never, ever carry a credit card balance. After the 401k plan with the match, the second highest return you can earn in all likelihood in 2015 is by not carrying that credit card balance and avoiding that 12 to 30% in annual interest the credit card company is going to charge you.
And for retirees, for instance, obviously never carry a credit card balance is a terrific one, but putting enough in a 401k to get employee match, they're beyond that. So for retirees especially, what's an important rule of the road in 2015 to follow?
One of the standard rules out there, a lot of people have heard at this point, is the 4% withdrawal rate. What that is, is that for every $100,000 you have saved, you can reasonably withdraw $4,000 every year in retirement. So if you have a $500,000 portfolio, you could pull out $20,000 and use that to supplement whatever you're getting from Social Security and whatever you're getting from a traditional company pension plan. So one thing the retirees ought to do is sit down, look at their spending in 2015, and say, you know, am I withdrawing too much from their from my portfolio? And an added caveat here, if we do get rough financial markets in 2015 and you see your portfolio's value drop sharply, one thing you might want to do is ratchet back your spending so that you withdraw somewhat less than that 4%. One of the things that we know about retirees is they face this big risk called sequence of return risk. And what that risk is that they get hit not only with bad financial markets, but they're also withdrawing money from their portfolio at the same time. So essentially, there's a double hit. If you're getting a hit from the financial markets, you may want to reduce the double hit by making sure that you don't withdraw quite so much during those rough financial markets.
Jonathan Clements, thank you so much for joining us for this WealthTrack web interview. And the Money Guide 2015, I'm so glad that you wrote it. I am delighted that it will be available starting in January 1st and it will be completely current. Thanks, Jonathan, for joining us.
Hey, it's always fun to talk to you, Consuelo.